Next speaker is Rupak Mahapatra, and he will tell us about searches for dark matter.
Okay, can you hear me? Okay, it's end of the day and the speaker is tired, the audience is tired. So I'll keep it short, within 1 hour. But I promise there will be a few fun stuff. Let me make sure it is... I need that bottle. Okay, so it should work. Okay, let's see. That looks pretty good. Yeah, that's actually same on my screen, almost same. Okay, I want to thank the organizers. Maybe you can have the light a little bit, give more light so students feel like asking me questions. They feel more comfortable. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. This is a really great pleasure to listen to great talks. Very inspired by all the talks I heard. I'm going to talk about direct detection of dark matter. I'll tell you a little bit about what dark matter is, what sort of candidates that we expect. You know, basically, what is dark matter? How well do we know what dark matter is? Does it even exist? You know, those are big questions. And I'll tell you about how we go about hoping to detect it, tell you about the current detection technologies. Focusing a lot on my technology that I use is called cryogenic dark matter search, but also talk about a lot of the other major technologies, especially the ones that have resolved. And then I'll tell you how in this constrained situation or funding situation or scientific scenarios, the hope is to make detectors that can do more than just what the vanilla dark matter that you're going to look for. Okay? So hopefully that's interesting. And then I'll end with the outlook for the future. So what's dark matter? As I said, this talk is geared towards the students. So please, if you don't understand, stop me and ask me. If you look at the velocities of the planets and plot them as a function of distance from the sun, you realize that it does follow what you would expect from Newton's law. Okay, but you do that on large scales, stars, the visible stars, is the spin around the center of a galaxy. And you make the same plot, it's quite different. The velocity doesn't go down, it continues to move, it continues to stay flat. So basically you expect the stars to slow down as you go farther away, but they keep moving at the same speed. What drives the velocity of the stars? As you know from Newton's law, that has to be the mass that's causing this gravitational pull. So it must be that there's a whole lot of mass that's affecting the velocities of the stars that you can't see. So the stars are moving, but you can't see what's causing them to move. And it was seen 80 years ago, and the idea of dark matter was postulated by Zwicky. And then von Rubin did a lot of surveys of all the galaxies and found out that indeed that's a general phenomenon in all galaxies. Okay, so the cosmology has actually taken a great leap in the last decade with precision measurement. Cosmic microwave background, supernovae, you know, which was awarded with the Nobel Prize in 2011. We live in an astonishingly shocking world. We think, as scientists, having worked for such a long time, we understand everything about everything. Unfortunately, no. We understand less than 4% of the universe. Majority of it is unexplored, not understood. Okay, so what is it? I'm not going to focus on dark energy. Obviously, this is a dark matter talk. That's even more mysterious. That's the most mysterious things that we have no idea what that is. Dark matter, which my talk is going to focus on, we think we do know a little bit more because of the constraints. Okay, and this dark matter, just to give you a big picture, it is, like I said, it is everywhere. That's why it is pulling those stars, making them move faster. Okay, and so it's mostly, since it has gravitational interaction for sure, it does mostly clump at the center of the galaxies, but also there's a large halo. And as we're moving through this halo, we experience the dark matter. It's like a ghost. You don't see it, but you feel it. It's pulling on you. Or to give you another example, like, you know, the moon causes the tides in the ocean. On a no moon night, you also see tides. It just the fact that you don't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. And you can have other information. Now, here's the most spectacular example. This is a certain part of the sky looking at different spectrum, X-ray, and then lensing. Lensing means it's sensitive to the mass. because high concentration of mass can bend light. So those two give shockingly different views of the same part of the sky. Most of the matter is somewhere else, and most of the visible matter is somewhere else. What has happened is, apparently two galaxies have gone through each other. The dark matter, having very little interaction, passes right through, like a ghost. Okay, whereas the ordinary matter gets, which is more strongly interacting, it falls behind. This bullet cluster really solidified the idea that it's not modified Newtonian gravity, but it is really dark matter. Okay, so we see evidence of dark matter from the velocity rotation curves, cosmic microwave background, lensing, and also this direct gravitational evidence. So it's certainly there. What is it? Oh, it's getting chopped off at the bottom. Can you see it? Okay, so what is it? What we think has happened is after the Big Bang, of course, there is this large amount of energy. It could produce all kinds of particles. So dark matter might be a particle that got produced at Big Bang, and a lot of it has survived over the 14 billion years. Okay? And that's giving rise to this one quarter of the universe that still exists, that we can feel. Okay? So the question is, what is it? It's actually quite surprising that we've been studying particle physics for 100 years, and we just found the tail of the elephant. It's only 4%. How long will it take to understand the rest of it? Anybody's guess. But what do we know about the dark matter? It certainly has gravity. We feel the interaction. It doesn't have electromagnetic. It's dark. You don't see light reflected off it. Strong interaction, no. Otherwise, you would have found it by now. By nature, it's weak interaction. It may or may not. But certainly, our first simplest deduction is that it has weak interaction. So you're looking for a particle that has weak interaction. And based on other information that we have, for example, astrophysical measurements, that one quarter of the universe has dark matter, and using standard model particle physics, it turns out that it should be a heavy particle with weak interaction cross-section. When you look at the periodic table of high energy physics, which is called the standard model, you don't see such a particle, as you have heard many, many times. So I'll gloss over it, but so it must be something beyond the standard model. It turns out, as you heard, supersymmetry TeV scale does give rise to the same candidate. It could be a coincidence that you get the same massive particle with weak interaction, or it could be just the clue that you're looking for. So that's the most compelling particle, is really a weakly interacting massive particle. That's what you're after. Okay, so there are different ways people go around trying to solve this 25% of the universe problem. Okay, of course, it's a big problem, and we would like to understand what that is. Gravitational is quite spectacular bullet cluster. There are different ways. I'm going to focus on direct detection, which is a scattering experiment. The dark matter particle, if it is a particle, scatters off a terrestrial detector, and you detect the signature. People also look for indirect annihilation. Two WIMPs would annihilate, producing high energy particles that you look for. It could also be at LHC that you produce from a pair of quarks that you produce the dark matter particle that you're looking for, and it disappears. You don't see it, but that's the signature, okay? So I want to focus on direct detection. How exactly do we plan to do it? So first of all, in the LHC, of course, as you have heard many times, is the high energy particles collide, producing Big Bang-like energies, and that would produce a host of particles, and some of which would be hopefully your dark matter particle, and you see a missing energy using these giant detectors. Quite amazing detectors. Our detector is much smaller. If we put it there, it will be like a point. It will be like an electron in front of a nucleus. Okay? So what we expect to do with these small detectors, but very sensitive nevertheless, is as we plow through this dark matter halo, we want to have very sensitive detectors on Earth that recoils. So we expect that the wind, as the sun is flying through it, through the halo, the wind would recoil on one of the nucleons on your detector, and you see a signature. There are a lot of WIMPs out there, a lot of WIMPs. If you take just for at least one thing you can remember, that if you take a bottle of Coke at any point of time, there should be so many that you should put nutritional warning that you might be drinking dark matter. Okay, so a lot of it, but the problem is it's very weakly interacting. That's where the problem is. So the basic idea of a direct detection is, like I said, it's scattering a slow WIMP. Why slow? The WIMPs actually have very small velocities. It's Maxwell Boltzmann distribution. It's the sun plowing through it that's giving rise to this relative velocity. So it hits your nucleus, and you can do a back of the envelope calculation. It's about tenths of keV of energy that you expect from such a recoil. That's easy, because for reference, visible light is an electron volt. 10,000 times more energy should be pretty easy. That's why there are so many experiments all over the world looking for dark matter using direct detection. Okay? I'll give you this 5 second pauses so that you can ask me questions. Okay, so that's great. You're going to have a recoil from the dark, from the room. How are you going to detect? What's your medium? So basic simple ionization detector would be, take a piece of germanium, for example. The wimp comes and recoils and produces electron hole pairs. You apply an electric field, you collect the signal, and that's your signal, ionization signal. Okay? So that's the simplest detector that you can think of. But what rate? What is the rate that you expect? Is it one per 10,000 years, one per year, one per day? That will tell you if it's feasible or not. You do a simple back of the envelope calculation for the rate. The rate has to be number of target times the flux times the cross section. And you do this, plug in the number, general assumption about the flux, then you get a number that's uncertain up to the cross section. That has to be the weak cross section. So you look at Perkins and it tells you it's 10 to the minus 43. Okay, so then you plug in all the numbers, and the rate is, you have to wait, if you have a kilogram of detector, you have to wait a billion days to get even one hit. Nobody will fund you, right? Fortunately, physics is very kind. What happens is these slow wimps, they do not interact with the nucleons direct, sorry, with the protons directly individually. They do it coherently. So that coherence gives you this tremendous boost of the A square, and that gives you a more palatable rate of, you know, 1 per 10 kilogram days. That's something you can do. That's our lifetime. We can certainly do such an experiment. No, it is not an assumption, because the wimp is moving slow. It's like 200 kilometers. It's not relativistic. So it's not going to resolve your individual nucleons. So it coherently scatters out the nucleons.
So you're assuming it's elementary?
Yes. Yeah, the wimp is the elementary. That's what we're assuming. Okay, so that's good. What about the background? Then if you're drinking a glass of beer, if your germanium detector sitting a meter away, you'd see tons of particles, hits. So to do an experiment, you need to be quiet. So you put a shield, typical shielding, and I'll tell you more details. You bring down the rate. That's a general strategy for all experiments. Okay, and there could be cosmic ray background, there could be radiogenic, like radioactivity, that really messes up what you're trying to do. So you use shielding. So the name of the game really is you're trying to find a needle in the haystack. So to do, to find the needle, you really have to be very clever with what detector technology you have, what shielding you have, so you can really find the small signal on top of a large background. So the first thing to do is really go underground, because majority of the problem is really from the cosmic rays. You're trying to find a neutral particle with which interacts with the nucleons. Neutrons will do that as well. And muons on the surface, there are so many muons, they can knock off easily a neutron and give you a signal. And so most of the experiments go deep underground, so most of the muons are stopped along the way. Okay, because the minimum ionizing muons get stopped along the way. So there are many different depths of mines in the world. The deepest would have been Kola mine in India. Unfortunately, that's not available. Sudan, my current experiment, that's here. Grand Sasser, that's about where the INO mine would be as well, the lab. So all these experiments that go underground to get rid of the cosmic ray flux. The deeper you are, the better it is. Next generation of the CDNS experiment will go to one of the deepest labs in the world, the Sudbury mine, the Snow Lab. Okay, so what I'm going to show you now is what the typical shielding looks like. It applies to all experiments. There might be slight differences, but you have onion peels, various layers of shielding. You have active scintillator panels on the outside, so any activity here and in your detector means that you don't have a wimp. Why? Because wimp is hard to have one interaction. If you have two along the path, it's not a wimp. It's most likely a radioactive background, a cosmic background. Okay, so then you have polyethylene to moderate the neutrons from radioactivity, and lead to protect you against the gammas that also come out of radioactivity. So you have these various layers of onion peels of shielding. In the inside, this CDNS running the detectors at almost absolute zero temperature, 40 millikelvin. So that's typical layers of shielding. And most of the experiments that you would see, they would have those shielding. But of course, they operate with different technology in the heart. Okay, now that's fine. We reduce the cosmic rays. We have reduced the background using shielding, but you can't get rid of all the backgrounds. There are still millions of background radioactivity, because even your shielding becomes a source of further radioactive background. So you have to have detector technology. You have to know, you have to have physics help you do that. So the way it helps is the WMP that you're trying to find is neutral. It's going to interact with your nucleons, but whereas your dominant background, the gammas and the electrons, they will prefer to hit on the electron. They will ionize the medium through the electron. That's where the difference is, because when you hit a nucleus, because it's very heavy, it's the energy deposition will be very dense. So you don't ionize the medium very well. And also the V over C will be small. So it moves very little, very slow. Whereas the electron, being so light, gets knocked out, is very sparse ionization, which means it leads to better ionization efficiency. You collect all the energies in ionization. So that difference provides the discrimination. That's the basic idea behind CDMS and xenon, for example, or argon experiments, dual phase experiments. Okay, so this is a key slide that I would like to have your attention because it's actually a good idea to know what are the constraints of different technologies, different techniques that people use to find dark matter. The energy, the WMP, when it recoils, it's going to deposit some amount of energy. And that will dissipate into different forms, like ionization, phonons from the vibration, or light, depending on what medium you're using. Okay, now CDMS uses ionization and phonons. What it does is, when you measure these two energies, it provides you with a natural way of rejecting your background. Why? Because the electron recoil that I told you is excellent ionization energy efficiency, whereas the nuclear recoil is a poor ionization efficiency. That gives you the discrimination. And the phonon is always the true energy deposition. Okay, so now here's the key thing. If you look at the amount of energy it takes to produce one quantum that you can detect, there's a huge difference in the energies. It takes only a milli electron volt to produce a phonon quantum, whereas it takes about a keV to produce scintillation light one. So, which means there's a million orders of magnitude difference in the statistics. If you're looking for low energy phenomena, then it really, it sort of sets the scale of what technology you should use. Okay, so. That's something that you have to appreciate. Okay, so I'll start with the phonon detector, because that's what I use. So the phonon detectors, the main idea is you keep something ultra cold with a stable temperature. You have particle interaction. It's going to heat it up. It's like you drop a droplet of hot water in a cold water, and it's going to raise the temperature. You measure the change in temperature, and that's your signal. Okay, and it provides very good resolution because it has a lot of quantum. So the collaboration that I work on is the cryogenic dark matter research. It has about 20 universities in US, Europe, and Canada. The way these detectors work, the big picture is these are semiconductor detectors. They are cryogenically cooled, and they are photolithographically patterned sensors. It's like electronic devices, electronic sensors on the surface. It helps us measure the ionization and phonon energies. And the detectors are well hidden inside layers of shielding. Okay? This is... So these are in KEVs. Okay, so the detectors are stacked in, that's what a typical detector looks like, 3 inch by 1 inch, and it weighs about almost a kilogram, 2/3 of a kilogram. And they're stacked in towers of 6 detectors each. The detectors have 4 phonon channels on the one side and 2 ionization on the other side. The details is not important to go into the details, but it tells you the real measure of both ionization and phonon energies, because that's the name of the game. When an interaction happens, it produces electron hole pairs and also the vibration, which produces phonons. They down convert quickly and we get ionization and phonon signals. That's how we get our signal. Okay? The way the phonon sensor works is it's really fancy. That it's not so fancy for people in the business, but for others it might be. The detector that you saw on my top slide, it has about 4,000 sensors. It's transitional sensors. The actual sensors are thinner than your hair. I have sample detector with me if you would like to see. So it's really very, very small scale structures that you have. There are 4,000 sensors. The way they work, the photons from the recoil, they come and there are two layers, active layers, aluminum and tungsten. Aluminum is superconducting at that temperature. So it's, the superconducting band gap is small, and so the phonons break this aluminum superconducting pairs and produce quasi-particles, which are trapped by the tungsten, and that heats up the tungsten. So the very small deposition energy changes the temperature in tungsten, and that gives rise to a large change in the resistance. Okay, so that's our signal. Large, it's large dr over dt, and you read that out using squids. It gives rise to excellent energy and position resolution. As you see here, collimated beams reconstruct the position very well and the energies. So it works really well. And as you probably know, it has led the field over more than a decade in terms of precise measurements and a good understanding of the systematics. So in 2010, we saw two signal candidates, but it's inconclusive because it's on top of expected background of almost one event. Okay, so when you there's obviously nothing you can say except produce what's called a limit plot. A limit plot tells you that the cross section could not be above a certain line. Why? Because if it were, you would have seen more events. That's what it says. Wink nucleon cross section on the y-axis, and that's to remind you that in the textbook weak cross section is about 10 to the minus 43. And this is the Wink mass, unfortunately you can't see it. So 10 GeV, 100 GeV, 1 TeV. Okay, so the direct detection experiments don't care how massive the WIMPs are. We are sensitive to all masses. So that's where you see events. When you see events, then you have discontinuities because you're less sensitive at that point because you already saw something. Okay, so these shaded regions are constrained minimal supersymmetric model predictions for what the WIMP cross-section might be. But you know, it's really guidance, but not set in stone. Okay. So this is 2010 limit. So I will show later the xenon 100 limit. Okay. So no discovery yet. What next? The rate, as you saw, it's number of target atoms you have times the flux times cross section. God has given you the flux and the cross section. There's nothing you can do. You can't move into a different part of the galaxy or change the cross section. So all you can do is change n. So you make more and more detectors, but you have to do it cheaper and cheaper, otherwise you won't get funded. So our plan is we had CDMS Sudan, where the result that I gave you, right now we're doing super CDMS Sudan. It's 3 inch by 1 inch. It's about 2/3 of a kilogram. We're running, taking data. We should have some results soon in 2013. And those are our sensitivities. The next generation, which is called generation 2, because it approaches 10 to the minus 46 centimeters squared, the cross section. That will be in Snow Lab. The generation after that, towards the end of the decade, would be really giant, gigantic detector, 6 inch by 2 inch, that we are hoping by the end of the decade, we should have the technology under control and hopefully a project. But if you scale from the current cost, it costs about $350,000 per kilogram. So if you want to build a ton scale, it'll cost you $500 million. Nobody is going to fund you, right? So what do? Do you just give up and say, okay, germanium, it's not going to happen, ton scale, okay? So that's where we try to attack the problem where the inefficiencies come from. So detectors, to remind you, used to be made at Stanford exclusively. It takes too long in the common nanofabrication facility. It takes 2 weeks to make. Then the TC, the superconducting transition temperatures are all over the place. Then you have to do ion implantation and fix it. So each detector takes like 2 months. And on top of that, it's only every fifth detector succeeds. So you spend a lot of money, waste a lot of money making these detectors. So what we thought we would do is industrialize. And so at Texana, we set up a lab some external funding, a lot of donated instruments from the semiconductor industry. So that makes a big difference because now with industrial quality instruments, you have higher success rate and that drives down the cost. Okay, the way these detectors are made, this is again for the student's aid, how you make these semiconductor detectors. You lay down various layers of thin films on the semiconductor, and then you coat it with photoresist coating. It's like your film, camera film. And then you put the pattern that you want, then you're left with the detector that you want. Okay? So now the heart of the machine is this one. This is the deposition system. That's the one that was really the critical thing that we had to attack the TC. That's the heart of the detector, the superconducting transition temperature. Okay? This, by the way, is a piece of history. This was the one at Maxim Semiconductor Products used to make your power management chips for the first generation iPhone and Samsung devices. This piece of machine. And so we got it, and that's what we've been using, and it has really worked out extremely well. And this instrument allows to make four detectors at the same time. So you can make four detectors within 24 hours. That's much better than 2 months per detector. Okay, so it really, really helps tremendously. Then once you have a detector, then you coat it with photoresist coating. It's like your camera film. Expose it to the circuit that you want with ultraviolet. Then you develop it, and you see that the pattern develops here. That is the sensor that you want. You see that? How it develops. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward once you have the right instruments. Okay, now we have gone further. Instead of doing this wet etching, we are doing dry etching, so it's plug and play. So you make every detector the same as the previous one. Because there's a huge penalty if you make mistakes. 4,000 sensors. If you make one mistake, then your detector is dead. Of course, you can fix to some extent, but ideally you want industrial quality detector fabrication. Okay, and you test it, and then this is again a key slide. Why it's so important to get the superconducting TC temperature right? These are transistor sensors, but we don't bias those 4,000 sensors independently. They're biased into four channels. So you pick a point and bias it so that you hold it between superconducting and normal. So that a small change in temperature will give you a large signal. But if your sensors across the crystal have different TC, then you see you might have no sensitivity in certain part of the detector, or very different sensitivities across the detector. That was the case in CDMS, so you waste a lot of time doing position correction. It takes a long time to analysis. This is what the standard was in CDMS 2, plus about 20 millicare variation, we have brought it down to 1 millicare variation. So those industrial quality instruments helped. That's why we know now that we can do these detectors much cheaper. In fact, we have also cut down the steps that were needed. So improve the yield, and we don't need those ion implantation to fix TC. That has brought down the cost from $350,000 to $50,000. That's much more affordable. It's not just the cost has gone down, but also the quality. Remember, the phonons, I told you there's a lot of quantum. But if you really want to do a multitude of physics, then you probably want to push the limit on how low an energy you want to go to. As you heard in Boris's talk, maybe you want to go down to 10 electron volts. So you're really careful about not losing your phonons. So this is the circuit. Phonons come in, produce quasi-particles, and you trap it. This is an electrical connection. This is scanning electron microscopy image. This shows you on this wall what the circuit looks like. This is a CDMS2 detector made at Stanford. This is what we make. Better connection, more of the particles are collected. So you collect almost 100% of the phonons, which will allow you to drive down the threshold to as low as you want. And you might be shocked in a few slides how low you could go. Okay, so we know how to do this now. We can make these detectors, and we know we are good for the next generation and next to next generation. Okay, so our next generation proposal, G2, generation 2, to remind you, generation 2 is a term used for any technology that's going to go down to 10 to the minus 46 or so. So that's over the next few years, that's where the results will be. That includes xenon 1 ton, because the fiducial mass is only 300 kilograms in the xenon 1 ton, and LUX and super CDMS. And we recently increased the payload in the proposal from 100 to 200 kilograms, so we are competitive. Germanium is going to be competitive with other technologies. So that project cost is about $30 million. It's in the CD process. It should happen over the next 2 years. A ton scale for reference, it's nothing. I mean, it's up in the sky, of course. But just to give you an idea of the scale, economy of scale, if you do a 200 kilogram, it will cost you $30 million. If you do a 1,500 kilogram, it will cost you only $60 million. So it really pays to make large detectors or large projects. Okay, so this to show you, this is a detector that we need towards the end of the decade, but we are already making it. To just gives you a scale of that germanium technology really mature, It is a little more expensive than the xenon, liquid xenon, but we know how to make the detectors. So we know how to span this parameter space going down to, which hopefully will exclude all of the supersymmetric parameter space. Okay, what about the other experiment? How much time did I spend? 20? Okay. All right, so I'll now go into different other experiments. There's Edelweiss experiment in Europe that uses a fairly similar technology. They use germanium crystals as well. Except the phonon detector is very different. We use these transitional sensors which give us microsecond timing. Whereas this bolometers means it's recording really the temperature, change in temperature. It's not a dI over dt, but really the final temperature that we're looking at. So it's millisecond timing, so it doesn't give you position information so much. Okay, so and they unfortunately are limited by background, but they really have good ideas on doing R&D. In fact, we are now in the mode of having joint meetings with them every year or so to exchange ideas and how to make the time scale a reality end of the decade. Okay, and in Europe, Edelweiss and CREST, two competing experiments, they are joining as the Eureka collaboration. That's a time scale experiment. They'll probably use the germanium technology as well. Okay, the CREST, which recently has results, it uses a slightly different technique. It has a crystal. It's a calcium tungstate crystal. So it has phonons being produced from the recoil, and it has a phonon sensor. It's again millikelvin technology, but it also has a light sensor. This crystal produces scintillation light when there is a recoil. So it collects both the light and the phonon. Phonon is the true measure of the energy. And they see a lot of events. Most of it appears to be background, but you know it's inconclusive. They would like to reduce the background. They think it is from alpha decays from the clamps that hold the detectors. Okay, but we should hear more from them. It takes each of the experiments, you see, it takes really a long time to get your background under control and mature. It does take time. So all these three are signal regions, depending on which one. So there's oxygen, calcium, and tungsten. So each, because it's kinematics, I mean, they have different masses, right? So all those three bands are signal regions. So you just count, you know, each of those three corresponding bands. They see some excess, so what the produce is a inclusion plot, a result plot, but it's really, you know, with that high number of backgrounds, you don't really want to claim that you have seen a signal. But that's what the result is, that there's a contour that's is based on the number of events that they see. Okay, and both that and cogent, which I'm going to talk in a little bit, are excluded by CDMS and xenon experiments. Okay, now let me switch gear and go to a scintillation light detector. The competing technology, the dominantly competing technology is a liquid xenon and also argon. They're coming up pretty well. They're light detectors. They scintillate. When there's an interaction, they scintillate. You can pick any noble gas and liquefy it and make a detector. Pretty much, they do scintillate. The most efficient is the liquid xenon. In fact, the only technology that has been already demonstrated for wind discovery potential, not just detector potential, but wind discovery potential is liquid xenon. Argon still has some way to go, in my opinion. Okay, so these detectors, liquid xenon or liquid argon detectors, come in two flavors, single phase and dual phase. This is really sweet, the idea is really sweet. Because if you take these liquid scintillators, this is very dense. So it's going to, when the gamma, the external gamma, there, when it comes in, it will interact with your detector medium. And it acts both as a passive and active shield. So you get a nice internal volume that's almost background free. Okay, you do have to pay the penalty of this self-shielding, but you do get a very nice space. And that's what the beauty or the selling point of this liquid scintillator technology is. Noble liquid. The way the dual phase works, the dual phase is really leading the world. So you have a bath of liquid xenon and a gaseous phase with photomultiplier tubes on the top and bottom looking at it, looking at possible events. So let's say a particle comes in, it produces ionization, it produces electrons. You apply an electric field and you can drift these electrons. Okay, so it's, the inversion is slower than I'm speaking. So it drifts and you get more signals. So there's a primary light, S1, and a secondary light after you have drifted the electron and multiplied them in the gaseous phase. So this S2 light and S1 light, so primary and secondary light, gives you a handle on what the particle might be. Why? Just like CDMS, these electrons that you produce and drifted, they'll be fewer in number if you have a nuclear recoil. It doesn't ionize as efficiently. So that's the signal band, S2 over S1, secondary versus primary, and this is the GaN band. Okay, and this technology is really very, very promising technology. What are the single phase experiments in the world? There's XMAS that's taking data right now. It is large. It's about a 1-ton liquid xenon detector with a fiducial mass of 100 kilograms. Remember, the fiducial mass will be always much smaller than your actual mass because most of it at high radius, most of the volume you spend in protecting yourself. Okay, so that's why when you see this ton scale detector, 800 kilograms, it's really 100 kilograms actual detector of good fiducial. And with all this PNT, large number of PNTs looking in. The single phase detectors are simpler in design and probably less systematic. The another idea is to do the same thing except put argon in it. Argon is more promising for single phase because it has an additional advantage. The pulse shape from nuclear recoil versus electron recoil does have discrimination between what type of particle it is. Because with X-mass type detector, you just see events. You can't tell event by event whether it's a signal or a background because there's nothing more to handle. So argon is better in that respect because it gives you pulse shape discrimination. So most of the signal is in the first 150 nanoseconds or so. And so when you define a quantity, prompt photoelectrons over total photoelectrons, you see high number for a nuclear recoil versus electron recoil. Okay, the difference is, and this also applies later for Ku detector. When you get nuclear recoil, it's funny, it is just the same concept but opposite conclusions, but you get dense energy deposition. So the energy density is high for nuclear recoil, but the energy ionization efficiency is low because it's so highly dense. Okay, and so similarly for electron recoil, the energy efficiency is high, but the energy density is low. Okay, that's one of the reasons why this is so. Okay, then there is also mimicking. You know, you think about putting different targets. Should you start seeing signal? If you can change targets, you very quickly kinematically constrain what the WIMP mass might be. So that's also a cool idea, except the cryogenics is a little tricky because argon becomes liquid with liquid nitrogen, whereas neon liquefies it with liquid helium temperature. Okay, the dual phase, the most promising technologies in the world, in addition to the germanium detectors, is, and as you have seen, the leading results now come from Xenon 100 experiment. I've already told you how the detector works. The latest result from the running in 2011 and 2012, they see two candidate events. This is S2 over S1. Just to remind you again, this is the electron recoil, like gammas, and this is the nuclear recoil. So you see two events right above threshold, they expected one event. Again, you produce a limit plot because you haven't seen anything conclusive. So all the cross-section above this, you exclude. Super CDMS, Sudha?
You said
they
are genuinely wants to cluster or one.
No, there should be distribution. But it is exponential nevertheless because the recoil energy spectrum goes down very sharply. So you do expect more events at low energy, but if you see all the events at low energy, it's a little suspicious, certainly for discovery. Right now, they're consistent with the background. So Super CDMS Sudan is also taking data, and we should have some comparable sensitivity and have results next year. But Xenon 100 will continue to get more data as well, so they're probably going to lead the world over the next 2 years or so. Well, if you want to constrain the mass, you need a huge amount of events, huge number of events. Okay, I don't have the plot, but if you have one target, then you need about 100, at least 10 events to say anything, like 100 GeV plus minus 50 GeV, you need 10 events. And to more precisely do that, you probably need 100 of events. But if you get results from two experiments, then kinematically you get much more precise information. That's why it's really important for discovery that you have two different targets, not just to confirm, but also to measure the mass. Okay, so the competing experiment to the Xenon 100 is the much bigger, significantly bigger experiment in US, the liquid underground xenon. It's a 350 kilogram experiment, it's 100 kilogram fiducial. It's a really large experiment. So it's being commissioned. If it starts running fine and the background is not an issue, that will really lead the world over the next few years. But it hasn't gotten the results yet, so I can't really comment. But some of the ideas that they use are really much more improved compared to the Xenon 100. For example, the earlier result in Xenon 100, where the krypton impurity sneak in and they didn't realize until after they opened the box, that won't happen in LUX because they do residual gas analyzer monitoring of a bleed of their gas as they purify. So they would detect such impurities very quickly. Okay, that's what the surface commissioning looked like. So LUX is really very, very promising as well. If everything goes well, it should really dominate the world. Okay, so there are competing experiment two-phase argon detectors that are in Europe. The basic idea is still the same. You just accept liquid xenon, you have liquid argon. Everything else is really the same, essentially the same. But argon has had problems with argon-39 contamination. So now, even at 40 to 60 keV, they have to run at very high threshold, otherwise they're swamped with background. Even at 40 to 60 keV, they still have a lot of background. Also, there's a lot of uncertainty in the energy scale. But as you know, I want to remind you, all these technologies take some time. It's not that it's a bad technology. These are all great technologies. It just takes some time to mature and fully understand all the systematics. There's a lot of work going on to understand this better. Okay, so another exciting technology, it's a very different technology. This used to be used 50 years ago in high energy physics, bubble chamber, to detect low rate phenomena. That has come back and being used as dark matter. The idea is you have a superheated liquid that when there is a particle interaction, because the interaction, the nuclear recoil is so dense, the energy density is so dense, it can nucleate, make bubbles. So you can tune it so that it's insensitive to any electron recoil, because electron recoil, like I told you, low energy density. So you can choose a good point and be completely insensitive to electron recoil. That's your dominant background. But alphas still cause a problem, lots of alphas, but there has been huge progress recently in acoustic rejection of alphas because the alphas sound different. The bubbles somehow sound, they have a different frequency response when it's alphas versus neutrons. And the same technology is also used by Picasso. In fact, the acoustic rejection was developed by Picasso, another bubble chamber experiment. So the 60 kilogram experiment at Snow Lab, that should be really good for the spin-dependent interaction because of the target that they choose. Okay, now I'm going to spend some time on non-cryogenic crystalline counters, like DAMA. Okay, as most of you know, DAMA had claimed signal. They see this large excess, very clear modulation signal. So what is it? The idea is, why do you expect modulation? As the sun, I told you, sun is moving around in the galactic plane, around the center of the galaxy. But the Earth is also is not sitting still, it's also moving around the sun. So from summer to winter, the relative velocity between the Earth and the wind will be different, right? In one season, it will be going along the direction of the sun, in the other season, it will be opposite. So if you use kinematics, that should give rise to a difference in rate of events. So that's exactly what you would expect. So it's very exciting, but if this were true, then most of the other experiments would have already seen WIMPs. And that hasn't happened. So the question is it some other background? You know, at LMGS, the muon background also is known to oscillate with almost the right phase as what DAMA is claiming. So it could be systematic, but no one really knows. And again, you know, a lot of work remains to be done. Okay, Cogent. That's a late player, but it has made a lot of noise, news, whatever you call it. No pun intended. It's basically a germanium detector, just like we use, except the technology is different. It runs at 77K. It's a point contact detector. There's a P-type and N-type coding there. The small P-type, you bias it and you read out what signal you see. There's no discrimination per se for electron recoil versus nuclear recoil. So what you hope is you have good shielding and there's no other background. That's a pretty strong hope to make, and in fact, so they're exploring ways to improve this the shielding to much better state so that they could still claim that whatever they're seeing is really WAMP. So what you do is, the idea is, you look at your background and you see, do you see excess events as you look for signal. So you can get the background estimate from calibration and then look for signal. But unfortunately, the signal that they claimed has been rejected by both CDMS and Xena. So the cogent region has been excluded by CDMS and Xenon as well, depending on what efficiency you use for the Xenon light yield. There's a lot of controversy over that. So basically what we see is a background that's, an event rate that's consistent with background. The key is both us and cogent is germanium. So it couldn't be a different material effect. There's no way to get out of this that except it's probably background. Signal?
Yeah.
These are a lot of events, I forget. I mean, it must be at least 3 sigma. But the question is it signal or systematics, you see? So now, just to remind you, the energy scale, at this low energy, you want to be sure that your energy scale is correct. In fact, what you see here is 1.3 keV line, activation line, and 10.4 keV activation line in germanium. And we measure, those are expected lines, and we do measure them almost exactly where they should be. So we know that our energy scale is correct. Okay? Xenon, there's been some controversy as to the nuclear recoil energy scale. The light yield efficiency, unfortunately, as measured by different groups, can vary from 35% to maybe 5%. That's a giant factor, almost in order of magnitude. So that needs to become clear as we go forward. So as you look at low energy phenomena, you need to be careful. But of course, you know, people will do measurements, you know, and get this light efficiency under control pretty soon. Okay, so here is another slide that I would like to make sure that you understand. Why do we keep seeing this signal claim at low mass WIMPs? Low mass WIMPs seems to be really in fashion now. A word of caution is, as you go down to lower and lower energies, your background rises very sharply, and your efficiency drops very sharply. So you get double banked for this at low energies. And if you have that low signal to noise and large number of background, you're likely to have sometimes events in the low energy. And of course, if you make an assumption it's a WIMP, then it's a low mass WIMP. It's not surprising that there's a lot of noise about low mass WIMPs. But nevertheless, you want to explore and understand, maybe it is true. But that's a word of caution. Okay, it does really take many years to fully understand what exactly you're seeing. And if you're not careful, then your sensitivity, you could be taking data all day long, but you don't really gain. You get saturated by background. So you really want to be in the zero background limit. And CDMS and Xenon 100 really have shown it. But it's really challenging as you go down to, if you want to exclude the full supersymmetric parameter space, or at least the constrained minimal supersymmetric space, and you go down to ton scale, it's quite amazing if you think about it. The amount of background that you want is less than one event per ton year. Ton of detector, over a year, you want to see less than one event. That's just mind-boggling. But I think, you know, we physicists will always find way. Okay, so what are the ton scale technologies that are in the world? Like germanium, Ku, Max, a combination of liquid xenon and liquid argon, LZ, again, proposed in US, xenon 1 ton. Actually, this is 10 ton, because 1 ton is really generation 2. I forgot what 10 ton. And Panda X in China. That's also, there will be three large liquid xenon experiments in the world. Lux, xenon 1 ton, and Panda X. Okay, so it's a lot of competition, but you know, unfortunately in the US, the DUSL, the Deep Underground Lab, didn't happen, so there's always a question where you're going to put the ton scale experiment. So you look around, and then one of the options we have is, as you heard today, the INO lab. This cavern 3, that's a pretty large cavern, that has been designated for a possible ton scale experiment. So the verbal commitment that we might put our experiment there from the INO management. So it is, when you do the ton scale, it's a pretty large experiment. No country, single country can do it. So you want collaboration from US, Europe, India to do these experiments. Okay, it's an excellent opportunity for people, for students and researchers if an experiment should happen in India. The collaboration is initially formed by ScienceTube, BARC, Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, TIFR, Texas A&M. Initially it's being led by ScienceTube and Texas A&M, but it'll expand. Okay, so that's what you heard about direct detection. Now, of course, everybody is looking forward to the Large Hadron Collider, because if LHC should see something as supersymmetry, and let's say we get some guidance from LHC that, okay, the WIMP is really 145 GeV and the cross-section is 10 to minus, let's say 48 in the worst case, or 49. But that's okay, because then you know where to look for. And you don't do 20 experiments, you do one or two experiments and really know where to go. They become like collider experiments, giant multi-ton dark matter experiments. The challenge is, the landscape is, this is, LHC is limited not by cross-section but by mass, how massive a particle they can look for. Whereas for dark matter direct detection, there is no limit. If it's 10 TeV, it doesn't matter to us, we can still detect it. Of course, the number density will go down, but that's a different thing. But if it's two-layer cross-section, then we need to propose the right kind of project. But if LHC should see something, that's really very exciting for us. Okay, now, I want to remind you, it took 100 years to detect 4%, understand 4%. How long is it going to take to understand the 23%? It would be naive, personally what I think is, it would be naive to think that we really know it is really the WIMP, it will be 100 GeV or so, and it has a cross-section. That would be really naive. It could be anything. We should really keep our minds open and eyes open as well, okay? Because nature has ways to surprise us. That elephant might be a dinosaur for all you know. I don't forget whether dinosaur has tail or not. Okay, so as we go in this effort, now I'm going to change tracks a little bit. That's where the fun part comes in. You want to have facility, you want to make detectors. You're going to spend $100 million or $50 million to make detectors. They better be good. You don't want to have a binary answer. You want to do a bunch of interesting physics, okay? So going back to germanium technology, as I told you, we've worked very hard to get the quantum efficiency very high so we can look for very low energy processes. It turns out we can push it even further. This transitional sensor, they depend on the TC that you run it. If you bring down the TC, you can, and it, the energy resolution goes as TC cubed. So you tremendously gain by going to lower and lower TC. But the question is, can you really get there? Can you make a TC that you want? The way we have solved that problem is really having the two phases in the tungsten. It's a little too technical, but I hope you appreciate what the problem is. The tungsten that we use, it has two phases with 10 millikelvin and this is supposed to be 1,000 millikelvin, so 1 Kelvin. We fine-tune the balance and get the TC that we exactly want. But it took us a lot of effort because remember, there was a variation of 20 millikelvin across the detector. We got it down to 1 millikelvin. So right now we think we can get this. In fact, we have already gotten to a point where we can hope to get 50 electron volt threshold. Why is it so important? Look at the energy spectrum for different mass WIMPs. If you're looking for low mass WIMPs, this is exponential energy spectrum. If your threshold is here, you're never going to detect a 10 GeV because you're going to integrate the rate above that threshold energy. So it's very important that your threshold is everything. Your threshold and your background, they're everything for these searches, even for dark matter, because these are really exponentially going, they go down exponentially. We have achieved almost 50 electron volt resolution, now eventually plan to do 10 electron volt that Bruce was talking about. Okay, now with this detector, with this very low threshold detector, you can do a whole bunch of things. A lot of interesting ideas that you, light dark matter. If it's light dark matter, it's obvious you need very low threshold. It could be MeV, it could be a few MeV dark matter, we would still detect it. One of the things that we worked on CDMS is solar axions. Axion, the zero scalar mesons, they could be produced by Primakov effect in sun. The photon would get converted in the strong nuclear field into an axion. Then you hope that when it comes to the Earth, you do the reverse. Take axion and produce photon and detect. And it has a unique signature because the photon will undergo the black scattering will produce a very unique feature of the energy versus time of the day because the sun is a different angle relative to your crystal. And we got very exciting limits. This was 3 years ago, 4 years ago. We were analyzing the new data, and what we compared it with, like Tokyo Helioscope, which basically looks at solar axion using a strong magnet here to convert the axion back to the photon. And of course, at LSC, they have very strong magnet technology, so they will be much more competitive in this search. But certainly, it's interesting. Now, what you heard, this is stolen directly from the Ursus talk. Is walking in perfect timing. So coherent neutral current scattering. Okay, as you heard, the Z doesn't care about the flavor of the neutrino. So if you do see some oscillation, it must be due to a different flavor. But why has nobody ever done it? You realize that this cross section, the coherent neutrino scattering on nucleons, as Boris was saying, it's actually pretty large. It's about 2 orders of magnitude higher than the textbook weak interaction cross section. But why has nobody done it? Because you don't have a detector with low threshold. The cross-section is high, but you have to have a detector so you can integrate above the threshold. And nobody in the world has this threshold except for us. No. So we can do this, this experiment, and look for oscillations, which would demonstrate then, if you do see oscillation, that they might be sterile neutrinos. The key is this: look at the rate, event rate, or the is a function of energy in electron volt. So if your threshold is 1 keV, you're not going to see anything using any medium. Even at 400 keV, you're not going to see anything. So germanium becomes interesting below 200 keV. So our threshold right now is this, so we integrate, we should be able to see something when we take our detector to MIT nuclear reactor. So a small collaboration of MIT, Texas A&M, Stanford, and we're going to make this detector with very low threshold. So we'll see what that happens. One more interesting thing. When you have really cool detectors, and if you keep your minds open, you can do a lot of cool things, certainly interesting things. So remember, are there fractionally charged particles? Yes, there are, quarks, of course. But they're always bound inside hadrons. Are they free? It's certainly a question that has excited many people, including Martin Pearl, who have been looking for such things. But unfortunately, those searches have been limited by, again, the threshold. And also, if you're a single detector, you could have low energy gammas that fake a low energy fractionally charged particle that you are trying to find. The unique thing that we have are 6 detectors with low threshold, and we use it just like in colliders, you would use tracking. So a low ionizing particle versus a strongly ionizing particle would be clear in our detector structure. So, and also what we do is, the basic idea is, as the particles go through, they would leave similar amount of energy and form a straight line track, 3D linear track. We find the expected background is really small. It's a zero background search. In fact, we have looked at some part of the data, 3%. This is the result we have. This is what the world result was, going down to 1/6. This is the world result, by the way. And we span down to 1/200 with sensitivity. So there's no other experiment which has sensitivity beyond this. Of course, these are large detectors, so in the part that they do have sensitivity, they have very good sensitivity. But they just can't go beyond that because of lack of threshold, and you have to have this unique multi-detector signature that cuts down the background, combinatoric background. So that's really exciting. So we now know up to this flux, there is no fractional charge down to 1/200. And it's arbitrary, the cutoff is arbitrary, but it becomes, it's asymptotic at that point. So okay, why are you all doing this? You never know how the new physics might come up. Because if the 4% is so rich, so interesting, the 25% may be very interesting. But again, I want to remind you, the dark matter is supposed to be the lightest supersymmetric particle, if it is supersymmetric. So it's probably, if it is really true, you probably don't expect a very rich spectrum for the dark matter itself, per se. But no one really knows where dark matter is. Okay, so I'll come to the conclusion. Certainly very exciting searches for dark matter with super CDMS, Sudan, Xenon 100, beginning to probe the constrained minimal supersymmetric space. Many promising technologies, but always the catchword is background. Is it zero background? If you want to search for WIMPs, it has to be zero background or sufficiently low background. For generation 2, going down 10⁻⁻⁶, that so you'll see results over the next 4 or 5 years from generation 2 experiment, the large super CDMS 200 kilograms, Xenon 1 ton, and LUX 350. All of those fiduciary masses tend to be about 100 to 300 kilogram experiments. Okay? But not all of them have the same level of background rejection. So you really need more than one experiment, not just to confirm if somebody should discover WAMP, but also to measure the mass. G3, the large ton scale, we don't really know which labs they will go into. There's a real shortage of large labs. Perhaps it will be in China or India or Europe, we don't know. Now, here's what my philosophy is. You want to have detector technology that can do more than just the vanilla dark matter. Who knows? Maybe dark matter is really not what you are thinking. It may be completely different. It could very well have been a very low fractional charge particle that behaves like a neutral particle and massive. But we just really don't know. We need to look everywhere. So if you ask, when will you detect dark matter? The two most powerful warriors are patience and time. Thank you. So I was tired, so I went fast. I hope, did you understand? Otherwise, if you don't ask questions, then I would think you didn't understand.
No, then you will ask questions, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm going to pick up. So we're going to have a session right after this talk. Yes, please. Yes.
Are there any evidence for the particulate nature of dark matter? Any indirect or direct evidence? That we know that...
No, we don't know. We don't know whether it's particle. It could be gravity, for example. It could be extra dimensions. We don't really know. We don't know whether it's really particle or not. The most plausible idea is that it is a particle.
Like some annihilation of two dark matter particles creating standard matter particles?
Well, if we see evidence for that, then yes, then we'll start believing it. Right, because if let's say there is strong signature from indirect detection, like a Fermi satellite, then you would start believing, yes, it's a particle. But there's no strong evidence for that so far. So unfortunately, we are not really sure whether it's a particle or not. We hope it is. Yeah, but you know, there are many, many interpretations. The problem with indirect detection is you really, it's like doing I used to be in collider physics. The difference between doing E plus E minus versus hadron colliders, you know, there's a very clean signature in direct detection, where indirect, you really have to model your background very well. So there could be a lot of astrophysical uncertainties that you really don't know about. So.
Sir, I have one question. You have mentioned that dark matter interacts with matter and then it creates electron and pairs. So it might be possible that neutrino also come and interact with the matter and create some new particles. So suppose you detect the dark matter, then how you will distinguish that whether this is some neutrino or other particle or dark matter?
So let me repeat if I understand your question correctly. You said that the way we detect it is the dark matter comes, the particle comes, the WIMP, for example, and recoils on the medium, the nucleus, and the recoil produces electron hole pairs. Okay, and then your question is how do you know whether it's not a neutrino that did that? That's an excellent question. In fact, as we make this large and larger detectors, ton scale, our dominant background, when you get everything else quiet, the cosmic and radiogenic background, it could be really the neutrino interaction. That's the limiting background. And unfortunately, I don't have a slide, but they do affect the different technologies differently, like xenon versus argon versus germanium. They affect, so for large multi-ton detectors, it could be the neutrinos are the dominant background. Sorry?
Solar.
Yes. Yes.
So the two events in xenon 100 you mentioned.
Yeah.
Can you infer a cross section from that, and if so, is that in the sensitivity range of CDNS?
So that's really, it's not. You don't want to make sensitivity when what you see and what you expect are really consistent. There is no reason to make. Because there's a huge bias. If you are doing it, you're assuming that, okay, this must be WIMPs. Why would I do that, right? Because I see two events and I expected one event. It's really consistent. Right? It's probably background. Or it probably could be one signal, right? We don't really know. We just have to wait for more signal. You can certainly make a limit, contour plot, 0.5 sigma or something, contour plot, but it really...
I guess the other way I wanted to ask this question is that within the sensitivity of CDMS?
By definition, they will be, because the uncertainties are so large, they are actually. In fact, the two events they see are 7 kV each, about 7 kV each. Yeah, they are consistent.
Okay, now I had a question, but the language is not complete. Xenon 100, in a maneuver that they made, they had a small input of air, so they have a small contamination. The quantity of krypton in the xenon is above the 100 ppt they had in xenon 10 kilos, and that's probably the reason of the two events. But after that, they distillated again the xenon, so should.
No, that one actually was the previous one. The three event was a krypton leak.
It was the krypton, no?
Right. The two event is not. I mean, it's the new result.
Yeah? No, but my question was about Duzel, because the concept of Duzel is a little bit confused to me.
But there is no Duzel now.
No, but they had in South Dakota, they had a fair amount of money, more than what was needed to build Gran Sasso, for this Suzel. So they came or not a laboratory there? My understanding that the laboratory will be made with the money they have already.
That's actually that's a small space, very small space. In fact, they don't even have enough funds to keep pumping for a long time unless DOE really commits to it. So the lab, existing lab, is small. It's not the large underground lab that we're envisioning. And also the idea of the Duzel was it would go down to 7,000 feet.
But that is nonsense. I mean, they have some money of the order of under $50 million.
Who has?
Huh?
Who has? Because the DOE, what the...
Not the DOE, the money from South Dakota and from Mr.
No, that's not true, because in fact, it costs about $2 million to pump the water per month. And so DOE has to scramble for money to keep it dry, because LOX was going to go in. They don't have $150 million.
Does not cost more than $2 million per month.
Something like that. It's a lot of money.
Per year.
In Sudan, it is not at all. It's like factor of 100 different to pump the water out. It's lower. Sudan is naturally dry. But South Dakota is not.
You just mentioned that the dark matter need not to be a particle. It can be the extra dimension or the other things. So are there any searches going along these directions?
So the LHC is really the best place to search for that. So there are limits on that. I mean, there are other people in the audience who would tell you that better. The limits on a search for extra dimensions.
I have one question. You said that dark matter candidates may have very small fractional charges, like they may.
That's really a possibility.
Just a speculation.
Yes, exactly. Okay. That's where we went and looked for it, because the thing is, like Gell-Mann said, anything that's not forbidden is required. So why should the fractional charges be all bound? Why not free? There's nothing that forbids them from being free. They might be. So that's why we went ahead and looked for it. And if you have very low fractional charge massive particle, it does actually would behave like a dark matter particle. It would not wash out galaxy formation and many other constraints. A 1/100 fractional charge is essentially neutral.
Thanks.
What is the limit you got to the fractional charge in the Horn diagram?
So this is the 3% data. So you would have to multiply with another 10. So this, can you turn down the light? Yeah, so this is the flux that's going through our detector per centimeter square per second per a unit solid angle. And so this is what the world limit was for small 1/1/6 dominated by macro. So if you one could do another version of this experiment. In fact, when we do this Super CDMO Sudan, was a supercilium snow lab, we'll have a lot of detectors. And we should have like factor of 100 better results. You know, almost approaching macro, but going like this, exploring the entire space.
But it's safe to say it's non-zero.
It's safe to say what?
Non-zero.
It's safe to say it could be non-zero.
Because I'm not saying it. Anything else? Any other questions?
A general question. You said in the end that when you go to ton scale detectors,
mm-hmm.
Because the cost involved and other things, it's better to have multiple physical aims, physics aims.
Right.
Now, with the kind of thing that you have in mind, this ton scale detector, what other possible physics aims can one have?
Can you turn off that light? It's too bright.
With some modification.
So for example, like I gave an example, search for fractionally charged particle, the ton scale would be fantastic. The other thing could be you take some of this low threshold detector near a reactor and really measure the coherent neutrino scattering, the cross section. We know what the expected value is, but we have not measured it. Nobody has measured. And then see if there's physics beyond standard model. You can't be in situ to do that. You have to take it to a reactor.
On the other hand, you can also, in the same location, for example.
Yeah, if you have
used as a neutrino detector.
That's if you react like in Japan, maybe, you know. But the thing is, the scale is like you saw. It's a meter scale, the oscillation, because you don't want the oscillation to happen before you have a detector.
No. It could be. It could even be a distant neutrino source, low energy. Fluxes will be small.
Yeah. But you certainly don't want to have the possibility that it has already oscillated before it saw any detector. Because I don't know if there are actually places where you have very large space close to a reactor, a large underground. And when I say underground, it's not 20 meters, 30 meters underground. It has to be half a mile underground, at least, so 1 kilometer. And then you need to have a reactor nearby.
You'll be surprised.
I'll be surprised. Okay, we should talk.
Okay, I think on this point we can clap once again and go out.
Thank you.